There we go. It's only on chapter 21, which is kind of nice.
So the topics on electricity in general that we're looking at here are more application-based ones than the theoretical ones that we did with like electrical charge and sources and two charges interacting with one another and the force felt between them. So this one I think is a little more application-based, so I think it would be easier personally for most students, because not much theory. Mathematically, where are we looking at math in this section?
What's
your take based on the problem set?
Where
do you think
the
math's
going to
come from
in
this test?
I think they will partially. Well, a lot of it was P equals IR, like that's
used a lot. So power in general?
Yeah.
Okay, I agree. Power is definitely going to be used in the test.
I need costs.
Yeah, so power with cost, the cost that that you're charged for the power you use.
I was going to say the first equation where you find the current.
So V equals IR all over the place, right? Rohm's law.
And the parallel series.
Yeah, and then breaking down and simplifying the parallel and series circuits and the combinations, right? So that's really where your math is going to come from. Theoretically, we talked about a lot of stuff in this chapter, right? We started with 21.1, where we started by talking about the definition of current and resistance. What was the idea there? How do they play a role with one another? How do they relate to one another, I should say? Because that's the important part, right? How do they relate to one another, current and resistance? It's the relationship that exists. Come on. If you're not sure, just write down Ohm's law. V equals IR. And look at IR and see how they would vary with respect to one another. If voltage was held constant, and you have more current or more resistance, what happens to the opposing one? Okay.
One increases the other. Or one increases the other.
They're inversely related to each other. Inversely related. So current and resistance always. So if I have a circuit with several resistors in series, those resistances get summed together. And therefore, I get a larger net resistance in the circuit, which is lowering my current. So in that example, when you guys did the lab, you had first a series circuit with one bulb, right? Then you had a series circuit with two bulbs. And all of the groups noticed it right away when they used a multimeter. The current dropped dramatically. You figured out the problem with the resistance. But the current itself dropped because now we have two light bulbs in that network. And those two light bulbs both acted as resistors, therefore regulating or slowing down the current in the circuit. The current provided or coming out of the battery, we could say. What else in 21.1 that we didn't, because this was before break, right? 21.1. Can somebody quickly look at their notes and see if there was one or two other things that we mentioned in 21.1?
Resistance and current the main topics. I'm not sure if I really went into a lot of other stuff in that section. Did I talk about a pentameter in that example? Was that 21.1? Did we use that phrase anywhere? Yeah? What else? What other terms in there did we talk about? Okay. So we talked about factors thinking. We talked about factors that affect resistance, right? We had a chart actually in 21.1 for that. And there were four main factors that affect the resistance. And some of them are logical. If the wire has a bigger cross section, right, more room for the energy to flow, it was less resistance. It's the same thing as taking your thumb and putting it over the end of a garden hose in the backyard. What happens when you put your thumb over the end of the garden hose? All those particles are still want to flow through, right? But they're flowing through a much smaller location. So we notice it kind of like they shoot out the side there, but there's like a little backup beforehand, before the water actually gets to your thumb. So if I had a narrowing in the actual cross section, I would have a slowing down of the electrons, the charge carriers flowing. So again, the wider or the bigger the cross section of the wire, the less resistance there is. If the cross section of the wire gets really narrow, becomes a very narrow wire, you have a lot of resistance. We talked about temperature, and the example I had you remember was like, you know what? Think about your computer. When your computer overheats and it gets really hot, everything starts slowing down, right? So think about temperature going up, resistance must also go up. Okay, if resistance goes up, everything slows down, meaning the current itself slows down. So temperature was a directly related variable to resistance. Cross-sectional area was indirectly related. How about the length of the wire? If the wire is longer, what did we say we had? When the wire was longer, if that a length was greater than another wire, is there more or less resistance from a longer wire? James?
More resistance.
Yeah, can you want to explain the logic behind that? Do you get the the idea? Think about what resistance is.
It's because there's more time that the electrons go through.
Okay, that's a good way to think about it. More time. What does more time do? Meaning it's taking longer to get through the wire, right? It's taking longer. First of all, how do charge carriers move? They move by actually the metallic atoms inside of the wire itself, copper. The copper kind of like bounces this charge carrier on and on into the circuit. So if it's a longer wire, there are more collisions between the charge carriers and the copper ions, and the copper atoms. So as a result, a longer wire, meaning more collisions, means more resistance. Collisions, in this sense, that's what you think about it, like something that slows down the flow, is resistance. It's resistance.
There was a fourth thing we talked about, material. Material of the wire affects the resistance. But there's no direct or indirect relationship there, because in that case, it physically depends on the material itself. We talked about things like, you know, well, gold is a better conductor than copper. I don't use gold to make wires. I don't use gold to make, it's common sense.
It's very expensive.
Yeah. It's very expensive in the end, right? It's very expensive. Now, obviously, you know, it's much less occurring on the earth, so it wouldn't make sense, but it's more expensive. So we don't use gold. But certain materials are better and worse conductors or resistors. We talked about those two terms that Aiden mentioned. One was pentiometer. If you recall, pentiometer is a dimmer. So this is not a light switch or a fixture that uses a pentiometer for resistance. Okay, that actual dimmer, that switch is on or off. In the lab, did anybody get to that? Did anybody get a chance to network bulb C and look at the pentiometer? I don't think we had time. It wasn't sharp. I think one group in the other class did. You can use that little pentiometer on the circuit board over here, if you recall. It was this little black knob that stuck out. And you could rotate it on and off, and it dimmed the brightness of bulb C. You would have to incorporate bulb C in your circuit to see that. But a pentiometer is a variable resistor. Your joysticks at home, the volume control on your TV, the dial that controls the volume on a stereo, anything like that, that literally changes something based on its intensity, is like a pentiometer. It's a variable resistance. What's usually happening is there's a certain amount of contact between the metal, and as you turn the joystick or rotate the knob, it increases or decreases that amount for like those old dimmers. New dimmers and new volume controls, I'm not sure how they work, but those spin indefinitely. So it's not about increasing or decreasing, you can spin that forever. Probably a digital, we learned that with that. The other word was superconductor. And a superconductor was something, if you recall, that does not need a lot of current to run, because it is a material with extremely low resistance. Extremely low resistance. And the idea 40 years ago was to try to find superconductors that could exist at room temperature. Most superconducting materials only exhibit that property at temperatures of like 10 kelvins or less, which is absurd. You're not going to have that in a regular common place, 10 kelvins. We're talking about pretty much absolute zero at that point. You talked about chemistry, absolute zero, the lowest temperature possible. Superconductors are very sought after at room temperature, though, and only a couple occur actually at that temperature. The idea of a superconductor, though, is to have very, very, very low resistance. Okay, so you apply a current, and that current will continue forever throughout that circuit. There's one other thing we talked about in that section, I think, as well. Did I mention drift velocity in those notes? I feel like that was a term that came up in 21.1. It wasn't on the last test, but I think it was 21.1. Drift velocity? Discuss with drift velocity. Anybody remember the term drift velocity? What it defined? Is it 21 moon? Is that me? Not there, no?
It is.
It isn't it? I think it's in there somewhere.
It is.
Anybody remember that? Just repeating what's in the notes, obviously. How to describe what drift velocity is? Can we discuss what it is? Not just reading it off the notes, but discuss what it is? Chris, you had like a hand up before you said that. You want to take a stab? No, man. Drift velocity? What's physically happening?
I mean, I'm 100% sure, but if I remember, I think it was something like with how the electrons move between the atoms, how they bounce off or something, and they're like shifting
unless you're on their track. That's absolutely right. The electrons, as they're going through the circuit, will collide with other atoms. So they can be like protruded left and right, moving left and right with no predictable path, really. So what was the conclusion we drew about that? The electrons, when they're physically traveling through the circuit, God bless you. When they're physically traveling through the circuit, what did we kind of conclude? Chris?
Movement's unpredictable.
It's unpredictable movement, good. That's one thing we concluded. It's unpredictable. There's a lot of collisions occurring.
It travels at 2.5 times second maybe four.
So what was the point of that? What was the whole idea?
The rest of the circuit is the speed of light.
Yeah, so the electric field that is in the circuit when I literally turn the switch on or off is established instantaneously because not instantaneously, bless you, but at the speed of light, very, 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 very quickly. Yet the electrons themselves are not moving at that speed, hence drift. They're drifting. In baseball, for outfielders, the term drifting is when there's a ball hit, and instead of running right to the ball and getting underneath it, a person sees where it's going to go, and they just kind of casually go there, and then they just make the catch at the last minute instead of being prepared there. Drifting, the idea of a drifter, someone who just moves along slowly, right? So drift velocity is the velocity of the electrons, but the actual velocity, not the speed of light, that the electric field is established at. That was mainly all of 21.1. We mentioned Ohm's law in 21.1, so let's write down some of that math. Okay, again, we mentioned Ohm's law. Units, voltage is measured in volts, current is measured in amps, resistance is measured in ohms. Okay, you should recognize the units on these always. We talk all the time about how word problems are very easy if you know what the units refer to, right? So if you know your units, you know what you're given in the problem. That can become very helpful. If I'm given something with ohms as units, I know that that's referring to resistance. Now, recognize that prefixes are also important as always. We need to know how to convert kilo-ohms and micro-ohms and milli-ohms into different things as well. That's it for 21.1. 21.2, okay, 21.2 is the idea of different circuits. We talked about parallel, we talked about series, and then we went into combinations of those two. What was the main difference? Can somebody tell me the main difference between parallel and series when it comes to circuitry? One major difference in this other stuff that come along, but how do you recognize the difference? You see it.
The current is always the same in a series circuit, but it's different in a parallel circuit.
Why is that?
Because the resistance changes when there's multiple branches.
Absolutely. That's the conclusion we drew on those two problems. I like that. Give me something else, though, physically about the circuit that is different, physically, when you see it physically, between parallel and series. How are they different?
For series, all the wires go out,
and then
parallel, it's kind of like
separated
between
the
wires.
So what word did we use? What did we say that the wires do? Yeah, they all branch off. We use that phrase. I said branch off, doesn't have to be the same words. But you notice that in parallel, it splits up, right? The current physically splits. That was part of what Aiden was talking about, the current being different because of the resistors, but also because of the branching that's happening there. Also because of the branching. Now, as Sophie said, if you remove a bulb that's in series, everything else suddenly stops working because removing a bulb in series makes it an open circuit. It's no longer as a continuous flow. But in parallel, because there are many branches, when you remove a bulb, only that branch goes out. Only that branch goes out. Now, be careful not to make a misrepresentation, I guess. Let's take a look at this one here. Series, parallel, both. Series, parallel, both. Series, parallel, both. Okay? Both. Follow the flow. Follow the flow. If you get to any resistor before a branching occurs, that's series right away. So this one right here is in series. These are in parallel with each other. We can resolve these two into one resistor using our resistance laws, and then this one here is in series with the result of these two. What's important though to notice is this, ready? If
I were to remove this resistor physically, the bulb blows out, the whole thing's going to go out. Even though those are in parallel, I said, oh, when you remove something in parallel, the other branches remain alive. This is the leading branch, isn't it? So physically think about it. The electrons flow out of the positive terminal. So there's my current right there. They're never going to make it to the parallel branches. The electrons want to get to the parallel branches. They're never going to get there because the part in series is no longer functional. So as a result, the electrons are not going to just jump over this. There's a gap in the circuit now if that bulb goes out. So the other two bulbs will also go out because the first series component went out. Now, with that said, please listen carefully. If instead this bulb goes out, well now the series or the circuit is still going to operate. It's just that branch is not going to work. So there's the current. This bulb will light up. This bulb will light up. But the one that's crossed off in red will not light up because it's no longer functional. But only that branch right here, whatever's along this branch, will go out. So if I put a second bulb in that branch, it will also go out if the first one in that branch goes out. So it's really important to recognize physically what's happening, right? The electrons are flowing out of the positive terminal. They hit the first bulb, which must turn it on. Okay? They hit this branch. This branch is open, so it can't go in this branch. So where do they all go instead? If this branch is an open part of the circuit, where are all the electrons going to go?
Up the other
branch. Yeah, up the other branch. So all the electrons in this circuit continue, and they go around, they go through this bulb, and then they come back into the negative terminal. Again, when that middle branch is broken, they just find another direction. Okay? They just find another direction. But it's really important to recognize that if this first bulb goes out, the whole circuit is out. Because there's no other option. When these electrons get to the first bulb right here, then they see, oh, there's a gap. They can't jump the gap. They have to go through some part of a circuit that has copper or metal or some conductive nature. Well, there is none. So that's an open circuit when that goes out. Remember, when I turn the light off and on, it's an open versus a closed circuit. And when the lights are on, it's a closed circuit. When the lights are off, it's an open circuit. How about a short circuit? What diagram should I draw for a short circuit? Yes. Again, this is it. Here's your short circuit. Okay, a short circuit is something that doesn't have a load-bearing element. Load-bearing elements are resistors, bulbs, capacitors. We've talked about the net. It's another thing that can take on the load. So we talk about the fact that the battery gives energy. Where does that energy go? If it's got nowhere to go, it's just going to heat up the wire. And it's going to keep heating up the wire until that wire usually catches fire. Okay, and we have a shortened circuit. But fortunately for us, in every circuit nowadays, you have a circuit breaker. Very good. And James, I'm glad you fall into the trap. It's drawn as a switch, so you can call it a switch if you want. But the phrase is circuit breaker. But a circuit breaker is an automatic switch. I can turn the light on and off with a manual switch. But if suddenly, hypothetically, I don't know why this would happen, but we were struck by lightning and there was a surge of energy in a building, the surge protectors, the circuit breakers, would detect a current influx. And they would say, you know what, that's too much current. Our circuit can't handle that much current, and we don't want our 3D printers or our computers to burn out or the projector to burn out because suddenly all this current is going through it, right? So the circuit breaker detects the current, instantaneously switches open. Open switch stops the current from flowing into those elements, prevents those elements from burning out. Just like air conditioners, just like servers in different computer rooms. Now, those servers, because they're really important, they have backup generators.
that when that current trips the circuit breaker, the backup generators kick in automatically. And they have batteries in the actual servers, so that the actual servers don't even power off for an instant. So there's no lapse in the connection you have.
Okay, how many of you watch Silicon Valley?
No one watched it, really?
Is that HBO? It's a good show. It's all about Silicon Valley and like the tech industry.
But in the very beginning of the show, the main characters are like making a startup company called Pied Piper. The whole idea behind it is that they've created this algorithm that compresses data better than anything that exists. So they're trying to sell it to companies like Google. In the show, they call it like one of them's called Hulu. It's like it's the equivalent of Google. So they're trying to sell their technology. And they're running all their servers out of their garage. So imagine the entire garage filled with all these computers, the supercomputers all lined up, because their compression algorithm is being used by so many companies that they have to run their servers. Well, in the process, they end up having too much current coming through, and at one point in the show, all their servers blow. Because their circuit breakers and their fuse protectors are not set up properly. Something happened in the show, I forget what happens exactly. But their servers physically overheat, and they start sparking and catching fire because it wasn't set up properly. So when we talk about circuit breakers, we have to recognize how important it is that we don't have a short circuit, because without a load bearing element, this was just gonna catch fire.
We had a lot of laws in parallel and series. They are given to you on the test, but you need to know how to utilize them. Okay, you need to know how to utilize them. So let's quickly jot those down. In series, we were told that the voltage in series is split up, right? It's split up. The voltage in series is equal to V1 plus V2 plus dot, dot, dot. The current, though, in series is the same throughout. And then the resistance in series is equal to a sum also.
That was our understanding in series. And it's logical in series. You saw this in your lab. The minute you hooked up the second bulb in series, what happened to the brightness? What did you notice right away happened to the brightness when you hooked up the second bulb?
It split in half or
it got bigger. Yeah, it went down or they decreased in general. Very good. Because what's happening when you have more than one bulb? The voltage applied or supplied by the source is getting split up to both of these. So each bulb only got part of the voltage. Well, what else happened? When I put more bulbs in there, what happened to the overall resistance? If I add 5 or 6 bulbs, what happens to the resistance in series? Well, I'm talking series right now, Chris. The resistance goes up. If I have 3 bulbs, it's like having 3 times that resistance. What happens if the resistance goes up? What goes down? When resistance goes up, what goes down? What things are inversely related? Current, very good. So let's talk about this for a second. This was part of your lab, right? This lab is not really due until tomorrow, I think, for you guys. So when I have multiple bulbs, from one bulb to 2 bulbs, I'm getting less voltage. I'm getting less voltage for each bulb. I'm also getting less current in the system because the overall resistance goes up. Again, take a look what's happening. The overall resistance in the circuit goes up because I have several of them, which causes the overall current to go down. Because I also have several bulbs, each of them gets part of the voltage, which means the voltage goes down. If the voltage and the current both go down, what is the product VI equal to? V times I equals what? V times I, or I times V, same thing, equals what variable?
Power,
thank you. So if these are both going down, what's happening to the power that each bulb is actually using? It's going down. Therefore, as James said, the bulbs are dimmer. The bulbs are dimmer when you add more bulbs in series.
Okay, that was kind of the summarization of our lab, right? That's how we summarize our lab when it comes to series circuits. Parallel. What do you remember? Parallel, what's the switch here? Talk to me about the switch. Not switch in the circuit, but what changes? What's the change here? You had the last couple. I'm glad you participated. Somebody else besides Isabel. Chris asked it a couple too, but go ahead, Chris.
You don't sum the resistance. It's an independent sum.
Yeah, what is it? It's a reciprocal sum, right?
Oh, yeah.
Reciprocal sum or inverse sum we could use. Very good. What else? What else? Something else is different. Look at your laws if you have to. Look at your formula sheet or look at your notes. What else is different, Katie? That's right. The voltage, very good, is equal across the board. Whereas, I'm leading you, right? I'm prompting you. Whereas, the current is now a sum. Very good. So what we're noticing here is that our laws are switched for parallel and series for voltage and current. Again, between parallel and series, the main difference we're noticing here is that the voltage and the current laws switch. And that makes sense for current a lot. The voltage in parallel is tough to get your mind around. I talked about that. But for current, it really does make sense. Think about branching off. If you have pipes flowing with water, and then suddenly you have one pipe that branches into two pipes, are each of those pipes going to get the same current that was coming in the one pipe to start? It's impossible. It can't. Again, water is coming into your house, and you, or let's say apartment, it's even better. Water is coming into your apartment. There is a lot of pressure where the pump is in your basement when your hot water heater is in the apartment building, because it's got to get up to maybe 30 floors. That hot water gets pumped from the ground floor all the way up to where you are. Now, if your building is tall enough, you have little hot water heaters along the way, because it would take forever for you. If you lived on the 30th floor, which is like the floor to live on, right, the penthouse or whatever in a building, and you turn on the hot water, and you have to physically wait for the water to get from the basement to you, it would take forever. It would be cold water for like 40 seconds until it got hot. You don't want to sit there and waste all that water. So you have, along the way, little checkpoints, if you will, where the water gets reheated. So it makes it easier. But let's say, imagine, okay, that you're in a five-story apartment building, which I live in. There's no checkpoints along the way. I'm on the fourth floor. It takes like 5 to 10 seconds in the morning for the water to heat up. Usually happens in the shower, but even in the sink, it takes 5 to 10 seconds. Because, again, that water is coming up from the ground. It's getting heated up in your hot water heater, whether it's a tank or the little new ones now. High energy efficiency one, they heat the water instantly. Really kind of cool, just like that. It continues after that hot water heater. And then, if the people below me are showering at the same time, I notice A, I get less pressure, and B, if the water's not as high. Okay, usually it's not as bad, but if there are like 3 or 4 apartments that are using the same water line, because those water lines all go up the same way, you'll notice the difference in pressure. That's like the current here. Right here, current and power. The minute there's a branching off, the current also branches off. The voltage doesn't. Okay, the voltage in parallel is the same, and that idea was because you're technically connecting the battery to each bulb when you branch off. You're connecting the leads of the battery to each bulb, so each bulb is getting that amount of voltage. Okay, the battery supplies. We did a lot of math in this section. Okay, a lot of math. The two examples in class are the best things to look at. And then I gave you an example at the end of the class notes and in the lab where you had to take a parallel and series circuit together and simplify it. So I'm telling you now, those are pretty much the typical kind of questions you're going to expect on the test. Okay, the kind of questions we have parts A, B, and C, where I ask you to figure out the resistance equivalent, then maybe find the current in the circuit, and then find the voltage or current across each bulb, depending upon if it's in parallel or series. But if I give you one that's parallel and series, I'm just going to have you reduce the circuit to one resistor, and that's it. You don't have to find the parallel or the voltage or current in each resistor or each part. Yeah? Okay? What else in 21.2 that I may not have covered yet that you can see in your notes? In 21.2, that we did not discuss yet. 21.2. Else? That was it. That was everything. Talked about open circuits, talked about short circuits. The workings of a light bulb, I discussed them. I'm not going to ask you like specifically to like draw a light bulb or tell me, you know. But if I have a figure on there, you should be able to recognize that electricity comes in one side, goes into the bulb, goes through the filament, and comes out the other side. Okay? You should be able to understand the nature of that. The diagram that I've been like literally referring to over and over again, of a simple circuit and the charge in a simple circuit. Remember, this was the diagram I kept referring to. It was potential energy, and the charge carrier started with a lot of energy. They left the battery. They hit the light bulb. When they hit the light bulb, the potential energy drops. They continue with that much potential energy. Maybe they hit another light bulb. Potential energy drops. And they get back to the battery here. And then at the battery, the energy charges back up. That's one circuit right there. Okay? So again, at the battery, right? At the bulb. So this is at bulb one. Right here is after bulb one. This is while it's in the wire. In the wire. This right here is at bulb two. In the wire. I'm sorry, no, not in the wire. Through the bulb. This is right here after bulb two. Then it's in the wire again. Then it's at the battery. And then here, after it hits the battery. Okay, so this is a very important diagram to recognize because this is what's physically happening to the electrons or charge carriers as they travel through a circuit. Okay, they start with energy at the battery. Energy is absorbed at bulb one. They continue through the wire. More energy is used at bulb two. They have no energy left. They go through the wire to back to the battery. In the battery does work. Does work, that phrase I keep using, on the charge carriers. When something does work on another thing, it either gives or takes away energy. When friction does work to an object, it's losing energy. When a battery does work on the charge carriers are gaining energy. Okay, this diagram is extremely important. Whether it shows up as a multiple choice or a short answer, it will not be a mathematical question, okay, but it will be a short answer or multiple choice. I'm not saying you have to recreate it. Maybe I will ask you to recreate parts of it, but you should be able to describe what's physically happening in words or answer multiple choice questions about, if I said to you, like, if I gave them segment numbers, segment number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 segments, right, line segments, I could easily ask you, which of the following statements describes what's happening in segment number 6, 5, whatever. You would have to choose the choice that says, the battery is doing work on the charge carriers and therefore increasing the amount of potential energy in them. So understanding what each segment is happening. Right, Chris, you're ahead.
That's in a series circuit, right?
This is in a simple series circuit. Yes, good point, Chris. Okay? This is in a simple series circuit. Now, I gave two bulbs in this. There could be as many bulbs as you want. Okay, but in a simple series circuit, so understand it with at least one bulb. Yeah, in parallel, it'd be a little bit different. And in an alternating current circuit, it'd be even more different. Okay? So this is direct current, DC current, right? Not alternating current. And with a series circuit. All right. The last section was 21.3. And 21.3 was all about power. Power is the rate at which work is done. Or power is the rate at which energy is used. Or power is the rate at which potential energy in the charge carriers is lost. Now, those are all good definitions. But we started looking at these three. Okay? Those are the three formulas we use to calculate power. Depending on what you're given, you can use the different formulas. How about what I'm going to do with this part of the formula right here? What about this piece I just circled in blue? That was kind of important also, right? Why was that important? Why was that part of the formula, P equals E over T, important? And it's really delta E, by the way, change in energy. Yeah. Yeah. If you recall, to find the cost of energy, you take the amount of energy times the rate of energy cost. But to get the amount of energy, remember, you needed to use this formula and solve for energy. Tell me, people, would I solve this for energy, what do I get? Solving this for energy, what do I get? What does the equation become when you solve, rearrange for energy?
Chris, what is it?
E equals P times T.
Yeah. It's just power times time. Okay, so that's your formula really for cost.
But if I recall correctly, do I put this on your formula sheet? I think I put this, right? Energy times rate, is that what I put on the formula sheet? Okay, so energy, you have to recognize, comes from power times time. Comes from that blue circle formula top. What else was important about my units in this part? What did my units for power and time have to be?
Kilowatt.
Good, and hour. Because this is dollars per kilowatt hour, not kilowatt per hour. So this has to be,
remember, in kilowatts. Time has to be in hours because the rate is always in dollars per kilowatt hour. And that'll give me a units of cost of dollars.
Okay, that's just my dimensions. Again, make sense of your units. Dollars equals kilowatt hours times dollars per kilowatt hour. Kilowatt hour cancels, leaving dollars equals dollars. It is dimensionally consistent. Okay, it is dimensionally consistent. That's the phrase we use for that. Questions? We've got like 3 or 4 minutes. Any specific problem set that you were troubled with? Any specific questions you had?
No, so you give us the P equals delta E over T.
You're giving P equals delta E over T in an earlier part of the year. So it's part of the earlier, look at your formula sheet, it's on there. It's way earlier than it's in the sheet though, okay? So you have to recognize that to get this formula here, energy equals power times time, to replace that, it comes from a much earlier formula than the year.
Okay?
So these are the 3, Andre, I give you with electricity. You notice I put them in portions, right? That's the whole idea of the formula sheet. It's written in a way so that it's sectioned off for you. What other questions on the problem set did you have? Was it straightforward? Is that why there's no questions? Just give me nods. I'll just say like, real easy, okay, real hard. Okay? Okay to real easy, okay, real easy, okay to real easy, okay. So it's good to be on the upper trend. There's not much I can vary, you notice that, right? In these types of questions, in just a physics-based course like we're learning. If you take this in college, there's a lot more you can do with it because a lot of things involve calculus. So I'm not going to vary much at this point. Okay, a lot of the stuff you're going to see is going to be similar to what we saw in class, but maybe with a different arrangement, right? A different arrangement of the circuit. Maybe there's 3 or 4 in parallel or 6 bulbs in parallel. That doesn't make it any harder or easier. It's the same exact problem. I saw nobody this morning at office hours. Unfortunately, I have baseball right after school today. If you have a quick question beyond this, maybe come see me during a break. Okay, but I saw 0 people today at office hours. I'm hoping that's a good sign that means, hey, everybody gets this. We've been spending a lot of time on it. We did a real good lab and explained it. So let's have a real good test tomorrow. Remembering, tomorrow is 37-minute periods. The test will only be 4 pages, not 6. But you need to get here on time and start right away. Yeah. Extra time, email me, get yourself situated.
James, is it you? No, I don't know. On Andre?
Disconnect first and get in. Are you use AirPlay? I forget. You AirPlay guy?
I do.
Okay.
I do use AirPlay.
Where are you from? Later, Rodrigo.